Hi, I'm Ethan Weiner, and this is a video version of my AES workshop presentation from October 12, 2009. At that workshop, I was joined by hearing experts James Johnston and Poppy Crum, who each spoke for about half an hour. For length and other considerations, only a small portion of each speech is repeated here. Many of my demonstrations include audio examples. However, YouTube recompresses the audio, so you can download the original full-quality WAV files from my website.
I'm Ethan Weiner. I'm from Real Traps, but I'm not really here for Real Traps. I'm here for everybody. And with me is JJ, Poppy Crum, and Jason Bradley, who goes by Tiny in the forums. You probably know him in spots. And we're going to start with JJ. He's going to give a talk about, he'll tell you what he's going to talk about. And then Poppy, and then I'll do a presentation. Jason promised to pipe up often and loudly. And I have like 6 hours worth of stuff to present, so we'll get to what we can.
Okay. What I'm going to talk about is the basics of how the human perceptual system works, and obviously specialize in the auditory system. So once you get past that initial loudness analysis that happens in the cochlea, everything can be steered. Everything will be steered, even if you try not to.
What do you mean by steered?
Meaning, like if you're listening for, say, high frequencies, you won't even notice the baseline. If you're listening for the baseline, you might not hear high frequencies.
So in the context of what this workshop is about, listening to different kinds of AD converters and mic preamps, it's hard to hear the whole range at once is what you're saying.
Well, you focus on specific instances at a given time.
Right.
You can listen over and over and over and focus on different things each time, but that, in fact, is often the problem. If I play the same thing twice, you listen to two different things, you will remember two different things. This isn't hallucination. This isn't deception. This is how your brain works. The problem is if you expect a difference, you're going to listen for different things and you hear different things, even if you have the same stimulus. And that's one of the really important points about doing any kind of auditory testing. If you listen to something differently for different features, you will remember different things. That's because out of that big sea of data, you extracted a different piece of it. It's just how we work. It's not an illusion. It's none of those pejorative words. It's just how the human being works. And if you have reason to assume things are different, you're likely to listen differently, you're likely to focus on different things, and you're likely to remember different things. Or maybe if you're convinced everything sounds the same, you'll steer yourself that way. So this makes the point, whenever you do auditory testing, that any test that you do for auditory stimuli has to have a falsifiable design. It means you have to actually be able to tell if there's something you actually detected or if it's something that you either consciously or subconsciously steered yourself into noticing. You have to be able to test that. Now, what this basically means is you have to do a blind test. Because if you know what the two things are, your brain is going to use that information. I don't care how smart you are, how trained you are, who you are, there hasn't been an example yet of somebody who can avoid it. It's just life. I did something a long time ago when I was in college. I put a big switch in a box, tied a single conductor inside the box, literally just tied a knot in the conductor, put it through a hole in the box, nailed the other end of the conductor to the back of the stereo cabinet. So this switch goes clack, clack. That is the total effect of the switch. And I labeled the switch tube and transistor. I had a burnt out Macintosh amplifier and one of those little Southwest Technical, pretty crappy 30 watt per channel plastic Tiger amplifiers. I had the two of them sitting there. Now, the Macintosh was burned out, the transformers were melted, half the resistors were gone, the capacitors had exploded. I don't know what happened to it, I got it out of a junk bin. So it was obviously the tube amp. I put in a little filament transformer in it so I'd light up the filaments to 5 volts, so they weren't even the right temperature, most of them, except for the rectifier, but I lit the tubes up. And I ran a test on some people. And some audiophiles that I invited almost unanimously liked the tube amplifier. And all but one of the double E's I invited liked the transistor amplifier. And the one double E who didn't have a preference flipped the switch a couple of times, walked up to the speaker, went like this, looked at it and said, "Smart ass." So this goes to show, it is not delusion, it's nothing of the sort, it's the way the brain works. People were just integrating this, and there was things like, this sounds warmer, this sounds clearer, this sounds more analytic, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I got news for you, all that switch did was go clack, clack. That was it. So this is one of these problems. You have to isolate the subject from this kind of information, or you will use it. It doesn't matter who you are, what you are. I have to do it to myself like I have to do it to everybody else. This is really an entire semester's course, and you wanted to hear this in 2 hours, so I'll stop. So now, Poppy, you got a bunch of demos and stuff, I think.
Something like that.
Something like that, okay.
Let's start with this, and we all know this tune. You can turn up. Interesting things when you play this backwards.
In that recording, I think forwards I could hear all sorts of interesting things. Right.
All right. You're just trying to get to my punchline. That's not fair.
Sorry.
So, let's try it with some lyrics. Obviously, it's really easy to hear lots of things when someone tells you what you should be hearing. That's what I'm trying to get at. That's a perfect example, and they start out knowing what they want to hear, but I think it's a good one. Listen to this.
The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
Let's listen to this again.
State governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
Okay.
The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
Okay. Everyone heard the word legislatures, I take it? Now, how many of you think you actually heard an S? I mean, I think I hear an S. I know the illusion. I hear an S. Okay? Now, listen to what's actually there.
The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city. The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
Now let's go back and hear this.
The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city. The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
It's pretty powerful, eh? So there are really two components going on here. We are programmed to hear speech, I will tell you that. We're also programmed to make expectations about what sounds should be. Okay, thank you.
Both of those were fabulous and very academic and very accurate and very important background information. This is like 3 minutes long, but I'm only going to play like not even 2 minutes of it kind of emphasize. This has nothing to do with audio, but I think we'll emphasize some of what we've just seen. Hang on.
We are going to show you how an innocent person, maybe someone you love, could be identified as a criminal. We're about to become an eyewitness to a crime along with these students at John Jay College. The man you see walking in is not a student.
Can I help you?
Watch closely.
Hey, that's my purse! Calm down. This was just a demonstration.
The thief is actually an actor. Psychologist Dr. Margaret Covera helped us stage this crime. She shows the class a photo lineup, what police would do after getting the description of a perpetrator.
Tell me if you see the person who stole the purse in those pictures, if you do, write the number of the picture down the sheet.
Would they choose correctly?
Things like hair color or facial hair may change.
We'll tell you how the class did in a moment, but first, here are six students we asked about their choices.
Just by a show of hands, how many think they definitely picked the right person?
Listen to some of their descriptions.
What color was his hair?
Blonde.
He seemed kind of chubby.
He was wearing glasses.
Wrong on all counts.
Your choice of number six.
Yes.
I mean, there's no doubt in your mind that that's the guy.
To me, that is the man.
This is number six, whom Erica and Andrew picked. Others said number one stole the purse, and number two, and number three, and number four.
I'm going to introduce you to our suspect. His photograph did not appear on the projector. All of you picked the wrong person.
The students had been so confident in their wrong choices, they said they'd be willing to testify in court if our crime had been real.
I feel bad. I would have sent the wrong man to jail.
What about the rest of the class?
I think that's enough, but I like the part, yeah, I would have sent the wrong man to jail, or maybe I would have bought the wrong sound card or something, I don't know. Anyone who records and mixes professionally has done this at least once in their career. You tweak a snare or a vocal track to perfection, only to discover later that the EQ was bypassed the whole time. Or you were tweaking a different track. And if you've been mixing and playing around with, whether you're professional or just a hobbyist, if you've been doing this for a few years and you haven't done that, then you're lying. But yet you were certain you heard a change. Human auditory memory and perception are extremely fragile. Expectation bias and placebo effect are much stronger than people care to admit.
If I can add something to that, I've also seen setups where there was an equalizer there for the producer to adjust satisfaction.
Right. They have the producer's channel strip that's not hooked up to anything. Yes, right. They call that. And these are the points, of course, some of you know me from the web forums where Jason and I are both active. But the result is endless arguments over basic scientific principles that have been understood fully for more than 50 years. The value of ultra-high sample rates and bit depth, the importance of dither and clock jitter, and even believing that replacement AC power cables can affect the sound passing through the connected devices. An entire industry has emerged to sell placebo tweaks to an unsuspecting public, in my opinion, of course. So let's look at some of the more outrageous examples. And I have some pretty funny ones here.
Oh, boy.
All right. This is, and I don't know how clear it is out there, but I think it's obvious that this is a jar of rocks.
Oh, boy. It's the Brilliant Pebbles.
Right. This is a real product. This is actually sold. I don't know how many they sell, but it's a real product, and you can pay $130 for these. And here's a typical application. You can take them out and scotch tape them to your RCA cables. And I don't know if you can, I hope the text is readable, but this was taken right off their website. And, you know, it's typical of hi-fi audiophile kind of silly prose.
Just to put them on your cables?
And different company. And it's the clip on the right, which I don't know if you can see, but it's really a crappy soldering job. And, again, this is real products. Personally, I think, hope that this is just, he's playing a joke on the audio industry. But I know at least a few people buy this
Peter
stuff.
Peter Belt is absolutely sincere.
Is he really?
I don't know about some of the others. Peter Belt is absolutely sincere. He believes it. But he absolutely believes it.
But why does he charge 500 pounds, which is like a grand, for a stupid alligator? This is. But people believe it. And you go to the audiophile forums where JJ and I, I don't even post a stereophile anymore. But there will be people that maybe haven't bought it, but say, well, you don't know it can't work. How can you be sure it's not going to work? I say, well, I know a little about electronics and a little bit about the frailty of hearing and why people might think it works. And these people will argue to the death that it might work, and you can't prove it doesn't. Well, okay, you're right, I can't. Maybe these guys are playing a joke, maybe they're not, but the products are real. These guys are dead serious, and there was a huge, you know, 20-odd page argument at Stereophile's web forum about this one that finally the moderator shut down. He should have done it, shut it down the first day. This art is right off their website. For size comparison, those things are about the size of a golf ball. And this is $3,000 for that. And they look really cool. I mean, I should take a cue and make some of my acoustic treatment products look like that. Except, of course, it would be, you know, really big. Well, then there's the Marigold Dots that are literally those little, you know, half-inch diameter paper things that you stick on to color to tell your kid that you did good, you know. And they say stick them on the windows. And they're not a lot of money. They're $20, $30. It's an impulse purchase. The hi-fi people say, you know, it's cheap enough. Might as well try it. And they sell a lot of these things for $20 that you could buy it. You know, Office Max for 40 cents. So this I took out of Pro Audio Review because it really, you know, I expect to see this stuff in the Audiophile press, but I really felt a little offended, I guess, to see this. And I was kind of upset when I saw they had a booth upstairs. If you guys are here, I'm sorry, but no, I'm not. And, you know, it's only $130, which is not, like, really stupid. But it's a power cord. It's a power cord. Let me say it again. It's a power cord. Audio doesn't go through it, and it's connected to 400 feet of other power cord that's Romex that's in your walls. This is an LP and CD demagnetizer. And think about that for a minute. And it's $1,800. I used to have a tape eraser for little ones. I used to have a professional one that in like the 1970s cost a couple $100 for demagnetizing a 2-inch reel of tape. But that was like $200, maybe $400 today if it's really good. But I mean, this is stupid.
How do companies convince otherwise sane people to pay $129 for a jar of rocks? Or $3,000 for magic bowls way too small to possibly affect acoustics? Or thousands of dollars for a replacement power cable? There are even audiophile-grade USB cables costing hundreds of dollars. More important, why do people think they hear a difference? Always an improvement, of course, with such products. Through my research in room acoustics, I believe the acoustic phenomenon known as comb filtering is one plausible explanation for many of the differences people claim to hear from cables, power conditioners, mechanical isolation devices, low jitter external clocks, ultra-high sample rates, replacement power cords and fuses, and so forth. Comb filtering is a specific type of frequency response error that occurs when direct sound from the loudspeakers combines in the air with reflections off the walls, floor, ceiling, and other nearby objects. This graph shows the response I measured 18 inches away from a reflecting sheetrock wall. In this graph and the previous one, you can see the repeating pattern of equally spaced peaks and deep nulls. The peak and null frequencies are related to the delay time, which in turn is related to the distance of the reflecting surfaces. This particular graph compares the response measured with and without absorption at the sidewall reflection points in my living room. Peaks and deep nulls occur at predictable quarter wavelength distances, and at higher frequencies it takes very little distance to go from a peak to a null. For example, at 7 kHz, a quarter wavelength is less than half an inch. At these higher frequencies, reflections from a nearby coffee table or even a leather seat back can make a big change in the frequency response at your ears. Because of comb filtering due to multiple reflections in a room, moving even a tiny distance changes the response a lot, especially in small rooms having no acoustic treatment. The response at any given cubic inch location in a room is the sum of the direct sound from the speakers plus many competing reflections all arriving from different directions. This graph shows the frequency response for two locations in the same room only 4 inches apart, yet it looks like different speakers in a totally different room. Keeping what truly matters in perspective, it makes little sense to obsess over microscopic amounts of distortion in an A to D converter when most loudspeakers have at least 10 times more distortion. This graph shows the first 5 individual components measured from a loudspeaker playing a 50 Hz tone. When you add them up, the total THD is 6.14%, and this doesn't include the IM products we'd also have if there were 2 or more source frequencies. Likewise, compared to even very modest gear, all domestic-sized rooms have huge variations in low-frequency response, comb filtering from untreated reflections, and substantial ringing at a dozen or more modal frequencies. This graph shows the low-frequency response at high resolution as measured in a bedroom-sized space. Does it make sense to obsess over gear when listening environments are by comparison so much worse? As audio professionals, we should strive for the highest quality possible. Of course. But it's important to keep things in perspective and be practical. My intent is not to belabor the importance of acoustics, but to put in perspective what parts of a playback system do the most damage. Most sensible people will aim to improve the weakest link first. There's also anti-science bias by those who believe specs don't matter and science doesn't know how to measure what they are certain they can hear. If it weren't for science, we'd all be banging on tree stumps in a dark cave. As JJ explained, every time you play a recording, it sounds a little different. Further, if you move your head even an inch or two, the frequency response can change substantially due to acoustic comb filtering, especially in an untreated room. And the more you hear a piece of music, the more likely you'll notice details previously missed. Is that triangle hit clearer because you recently added a power conditioner, or simply because you never noticed it playing before? Understanding that test gear is far more reliable and repeatable than human hearing is the last frontier in stamping out audio myths. Ultimately, these are consumerist issues, and I accept that people have a right to spend their money however they choose. I'm not opposed to paying more for real value. Parts and build quality, features, reliability, and even appearance cost more. For example, some DI boxes cost $30 and others cost 10 times more. If I'm an engineer at Universal Studios recording movie scores, which can cost hundreds of dollars per minute just for the musicians, I will not buy cheap junk that might break at the worst time. My only aim here is to explain what affects audio fidelity, to what degree of audibility, and why. The following four parameters define everything needed to assess high-quality audio reproduction: frequency response, distortion, noise, time-based errors. There are subsets of these parameters. For example, under distortion, there's harmonic distortion, IM distortion or intermodulation distortion, and digital aliasing. Noise encompasses tape hiss, hum and buzz, vinyl crackles, and cable handling noise, known as the triboelectric effect. Time-based errors are wow and flutter from vinyl records and tape respectively, and jitter in digital systems. Aside from devices that intentionally add color by changing the frequency response or adding distortion, it's generally accepted that audio gear should aim to be transparent. This is easily tested by measuring the above four parameters with various test signals. If the frequency response is flat to less than 1/10 dB from 20 Hz to 20 kHz, and the sum of all noise and distortion is at least 100 dB below the music, a device can be said to be audibly transparent. A device that's transparent will sound the same as every other transparent device, whether a microphone preamp or DAW summing algorithm. Of course, transparency is not the only goal of audio gear. Euphonic distortion can be useful as glue, but there's no need for magic. Transformers can add distortion, tubes can add distortion, tape distorts if you record at high levels, but do we really need to spend thousands of dollars on boutique gear to get these effects? Are there other more practical and affordable ways to get the same or similar results? Regardless, it's impossible to argue about the subjective value of gear color, so I won't even try. Although product specs can indeed tell us everything we need to know, many specs are incomplete, misleading, and sometimes even fraudulent. But this doesn't mean specs cannot tell us everything that's needed to assess transparency. We just need all of the data. Common techniques to mislead include using third octave averaging for microphone and loudspeaker response, and specifying a frequency response with no plus or minus dB range, or using very large divisions like 10 or 20 dB each to make a ragged response look more flat. I measured this loudspeaker from about a foot away in a fairly large room. This graph shows the true responses measured with no averaging. This graph shows the exact same data, but with third octave averaging applied. This graph shows the same average data again, but at 20 dB per vertical division to make the loudspeaker look flatter than it really is. Which version looks more like what speaker makers publish? Masking is a well-known principle by which a loud sound can hide a softer sound if both sounds have similar frequencies. This means you can hear treble-heavy tape hiss more readily during a bass solo than during a drum solo. Cymbals and violins contain a lot of treble, so that tends to hide hiss. The masking effect makes it difficult to hear artifacts even 40 dB below the music, yet some people are convinced they can hear artifacts such as jitter 100 dB down or lower. Compare that to test gear that can reliably measure down to the noise floor and gives identical results every time. Another factor is that our ears are most sensitive to frequencies in the treble range around 2 to 4 kilohertz, so distortion that lies mostly in that range is more noticeable and more objectionable than artifacts at lower frequencies. Intermodulation distortion typically contains both low and high frequencies, depending on the frequencies present in the music. Some IM components are not related musically to the fundamental pitches, so IM distortion is usually more objectionable and dissonant sounding than harmonic distortion. In a moment, I'll play a DAW project that lets us hear the relative audibility of artifacts at different levels below the music. With subjective listening tests versus measuring, it's mandatory to change only the one thing being tested. For example, recording different performances to compare microphones or preamps is not valid because the performances can vary. The same subtle details we listen for when comparing gear change from one performance to another. For example, a bell-like attack of a guitar note or a certain sheen on a brushed cymbal. Nobody can play or sing exactly the same way twice or remain perfectly stationary. So that's not a valid way to test preamps or anything else. Even if you could sing or play the same, a change in microphone position of even 1/4 inch is enough to make a real difference in the frequency response the microphone captures. Likewise, when the differences are subtle, non-blind or sighted tests are invalid because, as JJ explained, we tend to hear what we want to hear or think we should hear. This goes by many names: confirmation bias, placebo effect, buyer's remorse, and expectation bias. It's been said that audiophile reviewers can always identify which amplifier they're hearing, as long as they can read the nameplate. If you record a rock band one day with preamp brand A and a jazz trio the next day with brand B, it's impossible to assess anything meaningful about the preamps. One valid way to compare different preamps is to split the output of one microphone and record each preamp to a separate track for comparative playback later. However, a splitter transformer can affect interaction between the microphone and preamp. So a better way is with reamping, where you record the same playback through a loudspeaker of a single performance. Yes, the sound from the speaker may not be the same as a live cymbal or piano in the room, but that doesn't matter. The loudspeaker simply becomes the new live source, and any difference in tonality between the preamps being tested is still revealed. Another self-testing method is called ABX. There are freeware software programs that play WAV files at random, which you try to identify. But you must repeat a test enough times to get a conclusive answer. If you happen to guess right one time, that proves nothing. You'd have the same chance flipping a coin. Now, if you can get it right 10 times out of 10, that's much more significant. One big feature of ABX testing is you can do it in the comfort of your own home, whenever you want. You can even test yourself over many months if you like. This avoids any chance of being stressed while you listen, which some people claim makes blind testing unreliable. Indeed, double-blind tests are the gold standard in every field of science. It amazes me when some people claim that double-blind testing is not valid for assessing audio gear. Besides changing only one thing at a time, matching the A and B volume levels is also important. When comparing two identical sources, the louder one often sounds better, unless it's already too loud. This is mostly due to the Fletcher-Munson effect bringing out more clarity and fullness at higher volume levels. I can demonstrate a lot of things here in this video, but with lossy audio it may not be possible to hear more subtle details. So I've explained how proper tests are conducted and encourage you to try your own tests at home in your own familiar environment. People talk about stacking preamps and A to D converters in the sense that using the same preamp or converter for multiple tracks affects the result mix more than one preamp on one track does. Here, stacking means the preamps are used in parallel. Any coloration present in the preamp will be repeated for all of the tracks. So when all of the tracks are mixed together, the result contains that coloration. So far, so good. If the preamp used for each track has 4 dB of boost around 1 kHz, that's the same as using a flat preamp and adding an equalizer with 4 dB of boost on the mix bus. However, no competent preamp has a response nearly that skewed. Even modest gear is flat within 1 dB from 20 Hz to 20 kHz. But if a preamp does have a frequency response coloration, whether pleasing or not, it can be compensated for with mix bus EQ as just explained. It's not like mixing 20 tracks needs 20 times as much EQ to compensate. Now let's consider distortion and noise, the other two parameters that affect the sound of a preamp or converter. Artifacts and other coloration from gear used in parallel does not add the same as when devices are connected in series. In a little while, you'll hear a mix that was sent through multiple A to D conversions in series to more easily hear the degradation. But this is not the same as stacking in parallel. In series is far more damaging. This brings us to coherence. Noise and distortion on separate tracks do not add coherently. If you record the same mono guitar part on two analog tape tracks at once, when played back, the signals combine to give 6 dB more output. But the tape noise is different on each track and so rises only 3 dB. This is the same as using a tape track that's twice as wide, or the difference between 8 tracks on half-inch tape versus 8 tracks on 1-inch tape. Likewise for distortion. The distortion added by a preamp or converter on a bass track has different content than the distortion added to a vocal track. So when you combine them in a mix, the relative distortion for each track remains the same. Thus, there is no stacking accumulation for distortion either. If you record a DI bass track through a preamp having 1% distortion on one track, then record a grand piano through the same preamp, the mixed result will have the same 1% distortion on each instrument. Finally, subjective terms such as warm, cold, sterile, forward, and silky, and so forth, are not useful because they don't mean the same thing to everyone, versus 3 dB down at 200 Hz, which is precise and leaves no room for interpretation. Of course, warm and cold or sterile could describe the relative amount of high-frequency content, so saying subdued or exaggerated highs is better than sterile, in my opinion. Sometimes people refer to a piece of gear as being musical-sounding or resolving, but what does that really mean? What sounds musical to you may not sound musical to me. Some people like the added bass you get from an old-style receiver's loudness switch. To me, that usually sounds tubby, unless the music you're playing sounds thin. Same for a slight treble boost to add sheen, or a slight treble cut to reduce harshness. It's highly dependent on the particular music playing, and highly dependent on personal preference. I don't think we need yet more adjectives to describe audio fidelity when we already have perfectly good ones. The audiophile terms pace, rhythm, and timing take this absurdity to new heights because those words already have a specific musical meaning unrelated to whatever audiophiles think they are conveying. Now let's listen to some audio examples so you can decide for yourself what matters. Again, all of the original audio files are on my website. This first demo will help us determine at what levels below the music distortion and noise can be heard. For this first demo, I created the nastiest noise I could muster to serve as a worst-case example of noise or distortion. If you can't hear this noise when it's 80 dB below the music, you won't hear other noises at that level, such as jitter, digital aliasing, truncation distortion, or other types of distortion. I set the noise track's volume to minus 20 because when played at full volume, it's really irritating to hear. Have a listen. Now, let's hear how audible this noise is when mixed in at various levels below the music. Okay, that was pop music already mastered and normalized to minus 1 dB below full scale. Now let's hear a soft, gentle passage from my cello concerto, again adding the noise at various levels to tell when it can be heard. The average level of this soft passage is around minus 30 and peaks at only minus 15. Since the music is so soft at this point in this piece, the noise is actually 15 to 30 dB louder than its track volume indicates. Now let's move on to dither. does dither really have an audible effect, or is it just mental self-gratification?
And again, I never argue against dither. It's just that I don't think it really makes a difference, at least not if you have stuff normalized. And if I was exporting a DAW project to go to a mastering house, I would not do it at 16 bits, I would do it at 24 bits, and then let then they can raise it. Or if I was going to export it at 16 bits, I would just raise the output bus in Sonar so I'm not down in the noise, so it doesn't have to be brought up again later, and then problem solved. And it doesn't take long. You play it through once, you look to see how loud it ever got, and you go, well, I never got higher than -5. Okay, let's turn it up 4. You know, this is kind of practical stuff. But it's when I see these people in forums arguing, saying, oh man, I use the Power 3 dither with the high frequency triangular noise shaping, it sounds much more full. Now, wait a second. Fullness is a low frequency response issue. This is easily measured. Dither cannot possibly affect that. It just can't, unless something is broken. And we have stories that we've probably heard in the forums about somebody's dither was broken and it was discovered like 2 years later or something. I'm as big a propeller head as anybody, but it seems to me that this is really in the propeller head domain where you see people argue endlessly about, well, the spectrum makes a difference. Yes, it does make a difference. And the type of, yeah, I'm sure it does. But in practice, you can't hear. I have a typical pop tune I recorded and mixed myself and put on my website, and I rendered it at 24 bits and truncated parts of it, truncated the version, dithered of parts of it, and inserted like 2 to 5 second chunks from one file into the other. I can never hear. I've had a challenge on my website that's been up for 2 years saying, if you can tell which parts are dithered and which aren't, you know, you'll be famous. And I haven't even gotten one person answering, let alone one person answering wrong or right. I mean, so far, nobody has ever done that. I've had people say, well, that test doesn't tell you anything. Well, sure it does, if you can't hear a difference. Again, I don't argue against it. It just seems to me that that's not the reason you don't hear the fullness in your recordings. It's probably a lack of bass traps. Your speakers are not very good. They're not positioned very well. You're in the middle of the room rather than in a better, you know, modal distribution of the room. It's always stuff like that and not, you know, gear related when the stuff is 80 dB down. At least I think so.
Every time I've said in an audio forum that using dither has no audible effect on pop music recorded at sensible levels, it starts a huge fight. So let's listen and you can decide for yourself. To be clear, I don't advise against using dither or recording at 24 bits. We should always strive for the highest fidelity possible. And dither is free in all DAW software. But it's important to keep the value of things like dither in perspective. The distortion removed by dither is about 90 dB below full scale. So what I question is the claim that dither makes a huge difference in quality, especially as regards clarity and imaging and fullness, as some people report. I'd rather you decide based on a proper controlled test. To hear whether dither is audible when applied to typical pop music recorded at normal levels, I'll play 2 versions of a tune I recorded and mixed in Cakewalk Sonar. One version was exported as 16-bit truncated, and the other was exported at 16 bits using Sonar's highest quality Power 3 dither algorithm. I set up the track solo buttons in Sonar to toggle seamlessly between the 2 mixes. If anyone can reliably tell which track is dithered as I switch between these files, please raise your hand. This next example is Handel Brox from Don M. of Novare, converted in SoundForge from 24 to 16 bits using either truncation or high-pass triangular dither with high-pass contour noise shaping. This next example is called God Speaks, recorded by Lynn Fustin. It was converted in SoundForge from 24 to 16 bits using either truncation or high-pass triangular dither with high-pass contour noise shaping. By the way, the arranger is J. Daniel Smith from Dallas. When I want to test myself blind, I set up two parallel tracks in Sonar, as I did here, with the solo switches grouped while in opposite states. This lets me switch from one to the other with no clicks or pops. I put the mouse cursor over either solo button, close my eyes, then click a bunch of times at random without paying attention to how many times I clicked. This way, I don't know which starting version I'm hearing. Then I listen carefully to see if I can really tell which is which as I switch back and forth. When I open my eyes, I can see which track is currently soloed. This next demo lets us assess the relative quality of sound cards. Do we really have to pay thousands of dollars per channel for transparent audio? Is a prosumer sound card good enough to make recordings that sound fully professional? Even consumer sound cards these days are reasonably transparent, especially when compared to analog tape, whose degradation anyone can hear after only one generation. Again, I'm not really suggesting that people sell off their high-end converters and replace them with $25 Soundblaster cards. I have a Soundblaster only because I need it to edit sound fonts, which I still use for instrument samples. So it's not the sound card I normally use. But I believe it's a myth that inexpensive sound cards all sound terrible, as is commonly reported. This first demonstration switches between two versions of the same performance I recorded in my fairly large home studio. This is a very old photo, but it shows the 34 by 18 foot size of my workspace. My friend Greckham Jennings is playing the acoustic guitar. The signal from my DPA 4090 microphone was split after the mic preamp, so the single microphone was recorded through a $25 Soundblaster X-Fi sound card and also through Greckham's Apogee 8000 at the same time. This next demonstration compares a jazz recording, as extracted from CD, versus a copy after one play-record generation through my M-Audio Delta 66 sound card. The recording is the Lynn Ariel Trio, recorded by Tom Young for a Yamaha demo CD when the Yamaha ProMix 01R mixer was first introduced. Even if you can hear a difference, is the quality really that terrible after one generation? For this next demo, I started with a rendered mix of one of my pop tunes and recorded it out and back in again multiple times through the same Soundblaster X-Fi card. We'll listen to the original mix, then after one play record pass, 5 passes, 10 passes, and 20 passes. This way we can better hear how the sound is degraded. Even 16 bits with no dither through a sound blaster beats the finest analog tape recorder in every way one could possibly assess audio fidelity. Ernie Kruger once estimated in the Rec Audio Pro News Group that analog tape has about the same resolution as 13 bits of digital. I often see forum posts where someone is considering upgrading his sound card because he fears it's the weak link in his system. I always suggest this simple test. Take a CD that you think sounds amazing and record it from your CD player's analog output into your sound card. Then play back the recording and see how it sounds compared to the original CD. If the recording sounds the same, that proves the sound card is transparent enough not to be the weak link. For a final delivery medium, how many bits do we really need? For this demo, I extracted a copy of Chick Corea's Spain, recorded by the 12 cellists of the Berlin Philharmonic. If any type of music suffers from using too few bits, this track will reveal it very well. I'm using a freeware bit reduction plugin that can truncate audio in 1-bit steps. As I slowly reduce the number of bits, see when you can first detect the signs of degradation. What type of degradation do you notice most as the quality is reduced below 16 bits? I hear mainly the addition of noise and some gritty, trebly distortion, but the overall tonality seems mostly unchanged until we get down to 8 or 9 bits. I came across the freeware Decimate plugin a few months ago when a forum fellow named Dougie insisted the benefit from recording at 24 bits becomes more obvious when multiple tracks are summed. I knew that stacking accumulation is a myth, so I found this bit reducer plugin. Dougie was gracious enough to make two renders of his current tune, one with all tracks left at 24 bits, and another with this plugin on every track set to 16 bits. Using this plugin is equivalent to having recorded at 16 bits originally. Not only did the two mix files sound the same, and null, with only minor artifacts way down in the noise floor, Dougie actually changed his mind and ended up agreeing with me. Now that's a rare occurrence for an audio forum. Many people will tell you that phase shift is an audible problem. Some guy once bragged in a web forum that he can hear the phase shift in a 10-foot guitar cable.
A fellow argued with me once in a forum that he could hear the phase shift in a 10-foot guitar cord. And I said, no, you can't. You couldn't hear it in a 400-mile guitar cord, but you certainly can't hear it in a 10-foot guitar cord. And he was arguing. And I said, well, have you ever tested it? Do you have a way of adjusting the phase? And the same thing with the jitter. When I've had people say, oh, you know, low jitter clock makes a difference. I said, how do you know that? Unless you have experimented with a box, and forget the blind and double blind, unless you have a box that can dial in from zero to a lot of jitter, you don't know what you're saying. You're just parroting all the crap you read in every stupid recording magazine and every online web forum know-it-all.
In my experience, usual amounts of phase shift are inaudible and benign. By usual amounts, I mean the phase shift that occurs normally in audio gear like preamps and power amps. This next demonstration will let you decide for yourself. To demonstrate the audibility of phase shift, I'll use the freeware Sanford Phaser plugin. This plugin is functionally similar to the Little Labs in-between phase hardware box you may know of, though it's more flexible. Most phase shifters vary the phase using a single knob to control the center frequency. This type of device is also called an all-pass filter because it passes all frequencies equally, rather than boost or cut some frequencies as an equalizer does. The Sanford Phaser lets you choose how much phase shift to use from 4 through 16 stages. For these tests, I'll use 14 stages, which is a lot of phase shift. Most phase shifter effects boxes use 6 stages, and most amplifier circuits have less than 1/10 that amount. For this demo, we'll hear a recording of a solo cello played by my friend Kate Dillingham. Listen as I enable the phase shifter and vary the left channel's turnover frequency. Note how the phase shift is audible only while the amount of phase shift is varied. The timbre, or frequency response, is not changed. As long as the phase shift is the same for both channels, imaging will not change either. For this next demo, I'll use a funny recording made in 1962 by Dean Elliott called Lonesome Road. This is much more complex than a solo cello and contains the full range of frequencies. Earlier, I mentioned phase shift effects boxes, and it's important to understand the difference between phase shift, as demonstrated here, versus a phase shifter effect. A phase shifter effect is the same as this plugin, but it combines the shifted output with the original input. That creates a comb filter frequency response having many peaks and nulls, as we saw earlier. When you use a phase shifter effect, what you are hearing is the grossly affected frequency response, not the phase shift itself. The Samford phase shifter has a wet-dry control to mix in the original signal, but first I'll set the music to mono so I can adjust only one channel with the other channel muted. Now with the input and its shifted output combined, you can hear the familiar comb filter effect that changes the frequency response. Understand that phase shift is not the same as a simple polarity reversal. Phase shift is the basis of all normal equalizers. By normal, I mean minimum phase, not linear phase. Phase shift is a necessary and benign part of every analog equalizer's design. The difference between phaser and flanger effects is the number of peaks and nulls. A phaser uses some number of all-pass filters in series, and the number of peaks and nulls is half the number of all-pass stages. A flanger effect instead uses a variable time delay, so the number of peaks and nulls is essentially infinite. A null test is absolute because it can identify all changes to an audio file or the differences between two files. A null test can even identify distortion or other artifacts that we may not yet know to look for, as some people claim. If two files can be nulled, then they are audibly identical. Period. End of story. A null test can also be used to assess changes when using different signal wires, or adding a power conditioner, or anything else where you can record the same source material more than once. However, if files are recorded at different times, they can drift apart over time and not remain nulled. Some people believe that DAW summing is flawed because the quality is dependent on signal levels. I'll use this first example of a null test to disprove that myth. Modern DAW software uses 32-bit floating-point calculations, which is very high resolution. As a result, the distortion is extremely low over a very wide range of signal levels. Some people claim that high levels in the DAW causes distortion at intermediate stages, as happens with analog gear. I can only speak for the sonar software I use, but I never have this problem. This example plays a mixed pop tune through an EQ with one band cut. Then, a second track with the same mix in EQ boosts the volume sent into the EQ by 18 dB. Then I patched in a freeware volume control after the EQ's output, lowering the volume by 18 dB to compensate. you'll hear that when summed together, the two versions null completely. This test busts two myths. One, that all plugins have a sweet spot where they sound best, and two, that digital summing is somehow flawed. In my opinion, the only sweet spot that exists is due to the way Fletcher Munson affects our hearing. This next demo busts the myth that EQ cannot be countered exactly. For this test, I put the same music on two tracks. One track has two equalizers in series, but with opposite settings. That is, one has three bands of cut and the other has those same bands set to boost. Even after going through both EQ plugins, the result nulls perfectly with an unmodified version of the same mix. Again, small timing errors, drift, and phase shift can prevent two otherwise identical sounding files from nulling, even though the drift and phase shift themselves are inaudible. Drift won't happen in DAW software, but it does happen with analog tape and vinyl records. You can also get small amounts of drift recording the same thing several times digitally due to minor clock variations that are otherwise inaudible. I'll load the earlier file that recorded an acoustic guitar through a Sound Blaster and Apogee converter at the same time to show this. These were recorded into different sound cards, which means they had different clock sources. For this demo, I'll turn off the solo on both tracks, then reverse the polarity of track 2. Now you can hear the two recordings drift in and out of the null state. The EQ reversal null tests also tells us that simple response deviations, such as a microphone's low-frequency proximity boost, can be countered with EQ. It's much more difficult to counter acoustic issues caused by reflections because comb filtering is much more complex. But simple one- or two-pole curves can be undone with EQ. In tech speak, a pole is simply one stage having 6 dB per octave. Many microphones include a high-frequency presence boost around 5 kHz. There's no real difference between that and a flat microphone with EQ added, unless the boost is caused by the capsule ringing. When my partner Doug Ferrara bought a Neumann TLM-103 microphone, I brought my Audio-Technica 4033 to his studio. We set the microphones side by side, and I sang into both at once. After we applied an EQ curve to the 4033, matching the boost shown in the TLM manual, both microphones then sounded more or less the same.
All right. Thank you.